Shalom to Ishai Fleischer.
Shalom Matan, so great to be with you here on this program today.
God bless you, thank you. You are the international spokesperson of the Jewish community of Hebron. You write a lot for the Daily Wire, the Jewish Press. I saw on YouTube a lot of interviews of you, by the way, in Al Jazeera. So you know how to fight very well. I saw you on CNN also, great fights.
You know, we have to tell our story today because the fight is in media, it's in storytelling, it's in narrative. That's what I call it, the narrative war. And our enemies realize that they can't defeat us on the battlefield. They're not going to beat us with bombs. They're not going to beat us with rockets. We're going to be strong against them. We've developed an amazing military, thank God. So the battle is now in narrative. Our enemies have decided that the way that they're going to defeat us is by telling the young people of America, telling the young people of the world that Israel is a thief, an occupier, a pariah state. And instead of being what it is, which is a light to this region and a light to the world and a light of justice and liberty, and also the homeland of the Jewish people, we're being painted as thieves. So really what the battle that we're fighting for is reputation. And that's why I have the privilege and honor fight for Israel in that battlefield.
And you're doing it in Hebron. Hebron is very special. Also, it's the first land that we actually bought, right? God gave the land to Abraham, but Abraham chose to buy the land of Ma'arat HaMachpelah. It's a very, very unique and important place because the fight, the delegitimization against Hebron, it's very big. We feel it also in Israel. That's the reason that together we bring also Israelis to Hebron because also the propaganda is from within. But I want for a second to play the bad guy and you will be you. And really attacking the first issue. A lot of times you hear the occupation word, right? You are an occupier. What are you doing in Hebron? Hebron is a ghost town and stuff like that. So, and you hear it a lot. How do you how do you work with this kind of lies, with this kind of propaganda? Tell us your thoughts.
Thank you, Matan. You're absolutely right. Let me do what I do with a lot of groups. I break it down a little bit. We have to kind of do a little bit of surgery on the narrative. There's basically two main narratives, and a third one, which I'll also talk about, which are the heart of the anti-Israel effort today. The first one is that we are thieves. We are occupiers. We have stolen this land. This is Arab land, not Jewish land. And the way that you kind of get over that is you simply have to teach some history. You simply have to go back and say, look, 3,800 years ago, Abraham purchased a plot of land in Hebron. 3,000 years ago, King David had his kingdom first in Hebron. 2,000 years ago, King Herod, during the Second Temple, built a monument that's still there today. It's recorded in Josephus and in other historians of the time. That's the Tomb of the Patriarchs and Matriarchs. Then Jews lived there through Byzantium, through the first Arab conquest, through the Crusades, and through the Mamluks, and through the Turks, and through the Jordanians. Jews have always lived there. We have all the historical proofs of our existence there. We own property there. And we were at times an ethnic majority and at other times an ethnic minority. So the idea that somehow we're occupiers has to be undermined through just the teaching of history. We just have to teach people plain history. Because the other side uses lies. They say that we're a colonialist entity, that we're something like the British. No, we're not a colonialist entity. We are the indigenous people of this land. And you use the word God. Absolutely, God gave us this land, but not everybody believes that. So, you know, I'll talk about God, but I'll also talk about plain history, plain Jewish history, which, by the way, the world recognized 100 years ago, 100 years ago this month, on April 25th, in San Remo, Italy, the powers that defeated the Allied powers that defeated the Austro-Hungarian Empire and defeated the Ottoman Turkish Empire came together and they dissolved the lands of the Turks and they recognized that so-called Palestine is the land of the Jewish people and that they have historical right to it. So on the occupation, you have to fight with history. Then the next thing, after that they've established occupation, the next thing that they're going to tell you is that the Jewish people are abusers. And they want to turn it all upside down. They want to say that we are the ones who are abusing the poor indigenous Arabs and taking their life away. So first is the absurdity of it all. We are not. Israel is not the jihad. The jihad is a thing that suppresses both Jews in the Middle East and also Arabs who don't want to live by the life of the jihad also. So this idea that we're the oppressors, also you have to teach it by explaining that actually we're interested in normalization and a decent life here for Jews and Arabs. Of course, I mean Arabs who are not jihadists. And also to explain who the real attackers are. The real attackers are playing the victims. The real attackers are is the jihad. And here I just want to make a small point, which is there's a difference between Arabs and the jihad. I don't try to say that we have a war with the Arabs, but we have a war with an ideology that's called jihad. It's exactly the difference between Germany and the Nazis. We don't have a war with all Germans, but we had a war with all Nazis. And it's important to understand that there are people today in the Arab Muslim world here in the Middle East who believe in jihadism. So the real occupiers are not us. We are the indigenous people of this land. Occupiers are maybe the Islamic conquest that came here in 637 and again in 1267. They are the occupiers. And we are not the abusers. We are the light of liberty in this region, but we will surely fight back against physical attacks and against narrative attacks. Very, very short, Matan, just one more point I want to make to you is that there's yet another narrative that's out there that people don't always understand. They understand that there's an occupation narrative. They understand that there's an abuse narrative. But what they don't know is that there's another narrative, which is the fear narrative, the narrative that Israel is scary, that Hebron is dangerous. Don't go there. There's conflict there. It'll never be solved. And that's a narrative that actually the jihad likes. They like to seem scary. They like to make it look like Israel cannot calm a place down. They like to make people afraid to go there and see it themselves. So, in short, you got to overcome the occupation narrative. You got to know that it's our land. You got to know that we're not the abusers. Not the abusers. We're the light of liberty. And you have to not be afraid, because when you're afraid, you have succumbed to terror.
I want to ask you another question. In our project that we are doing together, we bring average bus or two every month of students, mainly of students, but also for people from the general public to Hebron, Israelis, and they don't know a lot about Hebron. They don't know, there is a lot of ignorance with the Israelis. And we are seeing it every tour, every time when we bring people, week after week, month after month. How do you handle it? Like, I'm sure you can understand when you're talking in the diaspora, when you're talking overseas, when people that don't know, it's natural that they don't know because they're not there. And they listen to the CNN or Al Jazeera. But when you feel this ignorance from Israelis, isn't it hard for you? What do you think about maybe the educational system, the academic system is problematic in Israel? Yeah. What do you think about that?
Well, Matan, you know, if it wasn't for an organization like Im Tirtzu, I would just tear my hair out, because I think to myself, how could it be that our own people are really so ignorant of Jewish history? It is painful. You know, Matan, it's not just painful in Hebron. It's painful a lot of times when I'm in the army and I just speak to my secular friends, you know, not observant, not religious Israelis, and they just don't know much about Judaism. So if you don't know much about Judaism, the word Hebron, if you're observant, right, forget about God for a second. Just recognize that if you're observant, that means that from time to time you're going to read about Hebron, how Abraham purchased it, how King David ruled there, how Caleb ben Yefune, you know, walked there. You're going to read about the Maccabees. You're going to read about so many things connected with Hebron. But when you're ignorant and your school does a bad job of teaching you Jewish history, then of course, you're not going to be as connected to it. You're not going to want to fight for it. And if the association that you have with the word Hebron is that it's just a place of fanatical Jews, but it's really an Arab-Palestinian town, and we have no business being there, then you're going to have a harder time fighting for it. That's why it's so important. I think maybe I'll reverse the question, and I'll say to you, if it wasn't for our tours, then I would be very frustrated. One of the reasons that we started our project together is that we came to the conclusion, your question was the conclusion we came to. People are ignorant. They're ignorant. We have to teach them. We have to bring them there. We can't, you said CNN and Al Jazeera, our Israeli newscasts are just as bad, if not worse. So we have to teach. We have to teach. We have to bring people there. We have to teach them about our history, our connection, our love, our passion. By the way, we also show them on our tours with Im Tirtzu. We sometimes go to Arab houses who have a different narrative. There are Palestinians and Arabs who don't have the anti-Israel narrative, who see Israel as a liberator, as the rightful owner of this land. And so we show them that even there's an alternative Palestinian narrative. I guess the answer is frustration is not the time that we're living in. We're not living in a time of frustration. We're living in a time of inspiration. And we're going to get out there, Hebron and Im Tirtzu and other organizations, and teach and teach and teach. And the heart of it is a historical connection, a godly connection, and a deep love, and a deep love. That love is sometimes misunderstood when they see that we're also willing to be tough. We're willing to carry a gun. We're willing to have an army. But we're actually very proud of that, because we are not going to allow ourselves to be abused anymore as we have been for the last 2,000 years. But that's not because we're violent people. We're actually lovers. We're lovers of this land, and we're certainly lovers of people who want to coexist with us.
I absolutely agree with you. I think one of the important conversations that you and I had a few months ago was about the fact that Vehigadeta is not only about the Exodus and Yetziat Mitzrayim, it's about telling your people the story about their roots, their history, and this is also some kind of a Higadeta, giving the story, connecting the people to Hebron, to the roots, to history, and also to the proportions. At the end of the day, you hear so much evil things about Hebron, and when you're getting there, you see that it's quite different. The proportions it's totally different, and then you can understand the same. Evil is about, it's not about Hebron, it's about Israel. And then people think that Israel is the black hole of this world. So also, like, because of this, Hebron is important. And here I want to talk about another reason that you and I doing this project of the tours. The fact that a lot of anti-Zionist, a lot of anti-Israeli agencies are coming to Hebron. I'm calling it BDS tourism, right? People who come, foreigners who come just to harass soldiers with cameras. People are coming to Hebron and this is only to harass soldiers. I want you to please, with your better English than me, a little bit talk about this phenomena that we suffer all over the borders, but very much, mainly in Hebron. Can you talk about it a little bit?
Yeah, you see, Hebron is a magnet for the anti-Israel, the haters of Israel. And if you're like an anti-Semite, you know, it's a boring world out there, because, you know, you can't be an anti-Semite like it used to be. You can't just get together and kill some Jews and make blood libels. You know, there's a strong state of Israel. There's a United States that's really more pro-Israel. So it's just hard to be an anti-Semite like it used to be. So the great thing that you could do today as an anti-Israel person, anti-Semite, is come to Hebron. You're going to stay in Arab Hebron, which is actually the wealthiest Arab city. So you're going to stay there, and you're going to have great coffee and great breakfast in the morning. And then you're going to go, after you hang out in this like really wealthy city, you're going to go to the Jewish side of Hebron. You're going to come to the 3%, that small, tiny street that Jews live on, and you're going to create a whole, you know, Occupy Hebron type of fight, like a kind of, classic IMF protest, against the World Monetary Fund, that kind of like anarchistic, leftist, activism focused on Israel. And so they love to come there, and you have there all kinds of groups. And then you also have, sadly, Israeli organizations like Shalom Achshav, like Yesh Din,
Breaking
like,
the Silence.
Of course, the worst of them all, Breaking the Silence, which is Shoverim Shtika. And these guys are dedicated to teaching an anti-Israel narrative. Again, that we're the occupiers and we're the abusers. These are two subtly different but important narratives. And they come there. Now, the problem is that our country, our state of Israel, has really not made strong laws against these kind of folks. I think that our government has not come to the understanding that this is today's weapon. You know, just like they wouldn't allow somebody to come and do a suicide bombing in Hebron, but they allow somebody to come there and teach that Israelis are thieves and Israelis are abusers and Israelis, you know, do all kinds of evil stuff to Arabs. You allow that to happen. Maybe that's not like a suicide bomb, but it has an impact on the world like a suicide bomb. It makes everybody afraid of Israel, makes everybody think that Israel is a dark place. And we have to have laws against that. Hebron is, I like to say to people, it's like a zoo. If you want to come and see, you know, the anti-Israel campus activists and those kind of folks, they live in Hebron. They come to Hebron. I think there's maybe one more reason why they come to Hebron. Maybe two more reasons, Matan. One reason is that, you know, when you're trying to get rid of weeds in your garden, your father will tell you, take it out with the root, right? Take it out with the root when you want to get rid of weeds. They understand that the roots of Israel is Hebron. They know that our beginnings of our Jewish history are there. And they know in their heart that if they can get rid of the biblical story, if they can get rid of the roots of Abraham, they can get rid of the roots of Tel Aviv. They understand that. Maybe sometimes they understand it better than us. There's another reason, and that other reason is because enemies always smell where you're weakest. They know that Hebron is politically weak, just like they understood that Gaza was politically weak. And so they attack it. They attack it. And they focus their energy on that. And they make more people and more people not like it and afraid of it and believe that, you know, we're just murderers over there and all that. So because it's politically weak, that's why they attack. And again, here comes organizations like the Jewish community of Hebron with a lot of courage to hold on. And then organizations like Im Tirtzu. I remember when you first started getting into this, I was like amazed. I was like, oh my God, Im Tirtzu is going to come in and help us with this crisis. I thought to myself, these guys are like firemen who are coming into our fire here and helping us put out this fire. And since you've come on the scene, I think that the leftist organizations, the anarchists, the anti-Semites, the pro-jihad organizations have been more not as willing to come and make as much trouble, but there's still more work to do, especially against some very, very sly and subtle enemies like Isa Amru, who's a guy who makes a tremendous amount of troubles for us and just constantly lies. Just everything that comes out of his mouth is a lie. And he puts on the clothing of a human rights organization, but in fact, his mission is jihadist. He wants to ethnically cleanse the Jews from Hebron. That's the truth behind what people like him are doing. They put on the clothes of liberalism, but in fact, what's behind those clothes is jihadism.
Also, on what you're talking, because there are not enough strict laws about people who are coming to harass our soldiers, of course, we developed a project that we are calling it Filming the Filmers, right? We are coming, Israelis coming with cameras, and they expose those agencies and anarchists in front of our live Facebooks, like this EAPPI, a Catholic agency that is against soldiers and thief that was since, I think 25 years, were in Hebron, and other groups are doing this, and our work also together to raise awareness about this lunatic phenomena that people just coming to harass soldiers and to just enjoy. I think this is insane that any country will give permission to do it. And in the Middle East, in such a dangerous neighborhood, to do it here, it's unbelievable. And here, this is another issue. This is amazing. when, for example, we are doing the tours, we always take the, our groups to the rooftops to see the proportions, because the propaganda is Hebron is apartheid city, a ghost town city. But when you're going to the rooftops and you see the proportions, you really can understand that this city is almost 250,000 people. It's a huge Arab city. And the Jews, they have a small quarter for themselves, and that's it. And this is amazing, the proportions, because the other groups, the anti-Zionist, anti-Israeli, anti-IDF groups, they don't take their parliament members from Europe to see Hebron from the rooftops. They don't take their tourists and their anarchists to watch Hebron from the rooftops. They don't, because they want to keep the lie alive. But here, it's also another different is that, for example, in our tours, if someone wants to go and buy from Arab shops in the Jewish quarter, we give them, we don't care. And from what I see a lot is all those groups, they don't allow the tourists to buy in Jewish shops. This is a very problematic, because you're always very careful. You don't say all the Arabs, all the Muslims. You say, you really see the difference. Do you think that those radicals also create damages and like make the conflict even bigger? When they come, is it make more bloodshed, more conflict to you as a residents of Hebron? Are they doing more damage than what we can understand? In your opinion?
Yes, that's a very good question, Matan. And I'll answer your question. Maybe it's a little bit surprising, but the truth of the matter is that while on the one hand, Jews and Arabs have had tensions in Hebron, we've had a lot of tensions. And Hebron is actually a Hamas-run city. There's a lot of Hamas in Hebron. So that's true on the one hand. It's really a jihadist city. It does not have any bars. It's really a very religious and therefore more likely to be jihadist city. On the other hand, there's a lot of people that want a more normal life with Israel, so-called normalization. They just want to have a more decent life. And in fact, we have a lot of Arabs, including a whole clan, that we have excellent relations with. By the way, recently I had a bat mitzvah for my daughter, and I needed fireworks. My family loves fireworks. So I asked my Arab neighbors in Hebron, I said to them, hey, you know, you guys shoot fireworks all the time. Can you shoot some fireworks for me over the Tomb of the Fathers and Mothers, the Tomb of the Patriarchs and Matriarchs, because that's where the party's going to be? And they were just so happy that I asked them. Of course, I paid for the fireworks, but they refused to take any money for the labor, and they just made it one of the most beautiful events. And so there are many Arabs like them, but they live in fear of the jihadists. So when these internationals come along, they even do more to create an atmosphere of tension. They love tension. That's what they're there for. They're not coming here to make peace. They're not peace workers. They're not human rights workers. They are people there to stoke and make more violence and more tension amongst us. I've seen many times when like Arabs are just like, kind of like, you know, we're there because we live there. They're there because they live there. They have stores. We have stores. Hi, ahlan, ahlan. We say hi to one another. We have decency in the day-to-day. Comes a European or some kind of foreign worker, and immediately there's a tense atmosphere because you got to put on the show for them, because they're going to sponsor, you know, more violence, because they want to see more violence, because they're going to say something, instigate more violence. They're going to instigate with the soldiers. Soldiers will get, will push back, and then there's a whole violent, intense atmosphere. That's what they want to do. They want everything but normalize. By the way, we just had a case, I'm sure you saw it, that a Palestinian kind of peace worker, human rights worker in Gaza set up some kind of Zoom conversation between Jewish, you know, Israelis and Arab Gazans, just to have a conversation, just to understand one another better. This was an Amnesty International worker put this on her Facebook page in order to let the Hamas people, she tagged the Hamas people so that they would know that somebody in Gaza is making normalization efforts with Israelis. And guess what Hamas did? They went and they arrested this Palestinian peace worker for cohorting, for being friends with, for having a conversation with Israelis. The point of that story, which just happened, it's in the news, is that they hate normalization. They need demonization. That's the effort that they're trying to do. That's what I said in the beginning of our discussion, that they're here to make a narrative war. To make a narrative war, you need demonization. That's one of the key things. You need to demonize the enemy. That's the whole point of this operation. And so when they come along and they also talk to the kids and they teach the young Palestinians that Israelis are bad, that Israelis are stealing their land, instead of saying, hey, you know, you can work with the Israelis. We could start having a more decent life here in Hebron. Let's get together. I mean, the Jews aren't leaving. They've never left. They're not leaving. Arabs aren't leaving. So let's get together and make some kind of, you know, better life. No, these so-called human rights workers, but really anarchists and anti-normalizers are just that. They're there to stop normalization and stop a decent life for both Jews and Arabs.
We are almost in the end of our conversation, this interview. I know that a lot of people always ask you about terror. We know that there were a lot of terror attacks against residents of Hebron. And we talked about people who benefit out of this conflict and also out of this terror. But I don't feel hatred from you. Frustration, yes, from the anarchists and from those people. But what do you think when Israeli organizations go to the United Nations, go to the European Union, they're calling to boycott Israel or to sanction Israel, because our presence in Hebron, because of our presence in Judea and Samaria, when you from one side suffer so much violence and terror, and from the other side you see people from your people from Israel going and take you're saying strengthening the jihadist narrative, it's even sometimes more than that. Hey, how do you feel with it? What do you think Israel needs to do? As I'm sure that people also in the diaspora, they ask you sometimes, well, if your government is not doing anything, why should I care? Maybe they're right.
First thing, it's important to remember that our government does something, which is it sends its army to Hebron, and it defends the Jewish presence there. That's a very important thing that our government does. It helps bring the electricity, it helps bring the water, it helps bring the internet, and it defends our presence there. Our government, of course, could do so much more. And one of the, I think, the diseases of our time is ambivalence. Ambivalentiut in Hebrew. Ambivalence means having two feelings at the same time. On the one hand, people like Benjamin Netanyahu, they know very well that Hebron is the heart of Jewish history and that Abraham purchased this plot of land. Benjamin Netanyahu has been there twice in the last year. And Hebron. On the other hand, it's still that ambivalence because they think, well, maybe one day we'll give it away for peace, or maybe one day there'll be no Jews living there. And that kind of thinking always leads them to not take it all the way, not to fight back all the way. What should our government do? I think our government should first thing decide, just like Trump decided about the Iran nuclear deal, that it was a bad idea. And what he decided to do with the nuclear idea is just to throw it away, just to turn around and throw it away. That was garbage. That was a bad move. That was a wrong thing to do. So too should Israel do the same thing with Oslo. It should say, no more two-state solution. It was a bad idea. It was a bad time, bad thinking. We have to reverse course. Instead, we're always still a little bit somewhere. There's a dream of a two-state solution. I say, let's kill that. Let's kill the two-state solution. Let's be sovereign in Judea and Samaria. Let's give decency and opportunity for decent people who want to live with us in coexistence. And let's strike hard against jihadists who hate Israel and want to destroy us. Let's be real about what's happening inside the mosques and on social media. Let's not wait for the mosquito to come out of the swamp. Let's get in there and drain that swamp, okay? So that's what we should be doing. Are we going to do that immediately? I'm not so sure. We're going to have to spend more time educating people and connecting people. The good news is that Hebron today has over 1 million visitors a year. We're the number one most visited site in Judea and Samaria. We have friends like Im Tirtzu who are teaching the truth about Jewish history, not just about Hebron, about Jewish history, about Jewish rights in this land. And so we're working very hard to get more people connected to the story. And of course, we're also working in politics to try to bring more of the right kind of politician to be the leaders of Israel, strong leaders and not weak leaders. So yes, we have a long way to go, but of course, you know the mantra, you know, internal people is not afraid of a long path. And we have been in Hebron for the last 3,800 years, and we plan to be there for the next 3,800 years as well.
Yes, and also it's always fun when you come with the groups with, and you ask someone, what is your name? And he tells you, Yossi. I say, oh, your name is Yosef. So 3,000 of years ago here in Hebron was someone in the same name that had the same shofar, celebrate the same same chagim, same holidays, same Shabbat. It's really a continuance of such an amazing story, and it is so important to keep it and to defend it. You say the ambivalence, I agree with you so much. I think the doubt, we say in Hebrew, Safek hu amalek, right? To penetrate the doubt to our heart and minds of the people. I think this is a very big enemy that also can penetrate if you are ignorant, if you were not in Hebron and not in Jerusalem and don't know your story. So I think it's amazing. Every time when there is a Chayei Sarah, the parasha, it's like a huge Woodstock festival in Hebron. Thousands of Israelis are coming for a huge celebration. It's so impressive because a few years ago, it wasn't empty, but it wasn't full of people in Parashat Chayei Sarah. And now it's such a big celebration. So you see the developments, right? It's keeping the hope, no?
Absolutely, absolutely. On the Torah portion of Chayei Sarah, we have 20,000 people that come and join us, including about 1/10 of the Knesset. I think last year we had 12 Knesset members. So yeah, you know, we have hope. We definitely have hope, and that hope gives us a lot of strength to get up every day and to fight. But when you ask me about good policy, there's a lot more good policy that needs to be done. And in general, if you look on the map of Israel, south of Tzomet HaGush, the Gush intersection here in Judea, there's a lot of land that has not been developed, and it's only been developed by Arabs and not Jews. And without developing that land, without making that corridor a strong Jewish corridor, strong Jewish presence in this historic highland, we'll be giving it up. The enemy is fighting on the narrative war. He's also slowly but surely taking over plots of land. And that's another, you know, great organization, Regavim, that's fighting that as well. And we have to be very vigilant. On the one hand, we're living in a time of hope where God has brought us out of 2,000 years of exile into the land of Israel. We've overcome the horrors of the Holocaust. The Six-Day War, we came back to our ancestral homeland. It's a time of miracles. But this time of miracles is also something that empowers us to be active, to get in there, to make sure that the destiny of the Jewish people is going to come sooner and better and stronger, and not allow one more child to be hurt, not allow one more child to be taught that Israel is a thief, and to make sure that our allies around the world believe in our story, understand our story, don't believe the other side's lies. So we believe in Judaism that the greater the goal is, the more holy the goal is, the more godly, the more awesome the goal is, the more challenges you're going to face. And it's going to take people with a lot of passion to get up every morning and to fight even harder than the bad guys to hold on to our land and to fulfill that great destiny.
Yishai Fleischer, God bless you, my friend. Thank you very much.
God bless you for all your amazing work, you, Matan, and Im Tirtzu in general, your great staff, and this great broadcast. Thank you very much for having me on.
Thank you. Thank you very much.